In my office, I have 8 panels that are amazing drawings of the HIV life cycle. I find them inspiring. I love looking at them. They're colorful. And I think that when you see a molecule in action, it's not so different from seeing a waterfall in terms of understanding that there's natural beauty there. We were always aware that HIV was an important medical problem. But honestly, when we started the work, we were mostly driven by curiosity. The two things that motivated us most were trying to understand how the virus makes a conical capsid. So that's the structure in the center of the virus that is responsible for replication. And then, of course, we cared about how does the virus use that conical capsid to do replication. The late Ute von Schuttler in our lab also did an experiment that was quite surprising in that she showed that even small changes to the CA protein, which builds the capsid, the virus really cared about that, and that those viruses were non-infectious. And so I think that was important for making people realize, including ourselves, that perhaps the capsid could be a drug target. We were actually contacted early on. Gilead contacted us and said, do you think capsid could be a good drug target? And of course we said yes. So we talked about what we were doing. We helped them set up their screening, but I want to emphasize the work in the drug development was really done by them. One of the really exciting developments is that lenacapavir's phase 3 clinical trials for the prevention of HIV transmission have been spectacularly successful. It's more potent than any drug available, but more importantly, it's very long-lasting. So what the phase 3 clinical trials show is that it completely protects people from transmission for 6 months. There are still 1.3 million new infections worldwide, and this could really change that trajectory. Of course, the rollout has to be funded and be successful, but right now, there's no reason to think this won't have a major impact. What we do is very basic research in our lab, but people's quality of lives are affected by what happens each day. Do they have transportation? Do they have physical therapy? Do they have good food? And so I think this, one of the great things about being at a university health science center is that there is this entire continuum of care. My brother, he's a world-class skier. In 2013, he was involved in a very bad ski accident and broke his neck and became a quadriplegic. And so he and his wife, they moved here because they clearly were going to need a support system. And it's been a privilege to be part of that system. Any quadriplegic has huge challenges. But the support at the University of Utah has really been amazing. We do an amazing job of rehabbing people. The Nielsen Rehab Hospital is as good as anywhere in the world. But most of people's quality of life is actually affected once they leave the hospital and go back into the community. We've been involved mostly as Derek's support system, but we were also involved early on in helping to create a small group of people who envisioned that life could be different for quadriplegics and others with long-term spinal and other severe disabilities. And so that has emerged into what's now a project called the 1U Center. Living through Derek's injury has, first of all, given me an amazing appreciation for the human spirit. It's also made me realize how important good medical care is. The University of Utah writ large has been an amazingly supportive community. So that's true from the level of our lab to the level of our department to the level of the Health Sciences Center and to the level of the university as a whole. You know, you have the sense that Utah cares about its flagship research university, and that feels good. We view ourselves as first of all, trying to understand the natural world, which I think has great value, great intrinsic value. But I guess we view ourselves as sort of the feedstock for new ways of approaching medicine. One of the things that I find very satisfying about what we do is that we're driven by curiosity to discover things that we don't understand. And I think that's not so different from other kinds of adventurers. You know, the same thing that drives people to discover or climb mountains, I think, drives us to discover how does a molecular machine work.